13, and tonight we're going to be studying Malchut in Matthew, studying from chapter 13. What we talked about last time is that in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 11, we find that there are Gentiles in Malchut. Malchut means the kingdom, and that there are Gentiles in the kingdom. By Gentiles, we mean, if you remember what we have discussed concerning Malchut, that the kingdom consists of everything. This is the kingdom. It consists of everything. And so, who's in the kingdom?
Everyone.
Who is in the kingdom? Everyone is in the kingdom. But not everyone is a citizen of the kingdom. The moment one becomes a citizen of the kingdom, we are grafted in if we are not in. I.e., if we are not a member of Yisrael, if we are not Jewish, then Rav Shaul tells us in the book of Romans chapter 11 that we are grafted into that tree. He tells us in the book of, I believe it's in the book of Ephesians, that we talked about the last time, that we become citizens of the commonwealth of Yisrael. He says you were not one, at one time you were pagans, you were idolaters, you were this and you were that, but now you are of the commonwealth of Yisrael. And so in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 11, we find out that it's not just believers who are in the kingdom. It's not just believers who are in the kingdom. That in fact, everyone is in the kingdom. But not everyone is a citizen of the kingdom. Let me get my screen up. So, in Matiyahu, in Matthew chapter 13, we have a series of mashalim. Remember what a mashal is? What is a mashal? A parable. Very good. A mashal is a parable. And remember, we talked on Shabbat, those of you who were here for Shabbat, we talked on Shabbat about this. That this is the way that Scripture is written, that it is not written chronologically, but it is written thematically. It is written by theme. And so it can get confusing, and people are confused, including some scholars are confused, because you'll find this here and you'll find this next to it. And you say, what's that doing there? Because that didn't happen. For example, in our Shabbat teaching this last week on Yitro, in Shemot Exodus chapter 18, the story of Yitro is actually out of place, because they have the striking of the rock, Erechdim, and then we have the attack of the Amalekim, of Amalek. And then he goes straight from that into the story of Yitro. But we know that Yitro does not appear till they're at Sinai, that he doesn't appear. And so that does not occur until later. And so the sages tell us, so this is out of order. It's out of place. This is not in chronological order. And so we spoke to this to remember that though the Scripture is historically accurate, it is not a history book. So you're not going to find everything in chronological order, but you're going to find that the Torah is written by theme, that Scripture is written by theme. And so the reason why the story of Yitro is placed down along the story of Rephidim and the attack of Amalek is a comparison. The failure and the complaining of Yehudim, of the Jews, of the Israelites, compared to the faith of Yitro, the Emunah, that Yitro, who is the Kohen Hagadol of the pagans, of the Goyim, he's the pagan high priest for the Midianites, and yet all he has to do is hear of the great things that Hashem does for Yisraelim, for Bnei Yisrael, and he comes to trust, he comes to faith, he comes to believe, and he joins with them. Whereas the Bnei Yisrael, the children of Israel, they've seen, they witnessed miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle, and yet what? The next thing that happens, what? They complain. And they say, have you brought us out to die? And so that is the reason why the story of Yitro is right next to Rephidim. It's not because those things happen back to back, but that God is comparing the one to the other. And so this is the typology of Mashal. We talked in our Judaism 101 class at 3 o'clock on Shabbat about putting Kepha alongside of Yehuda, putting Peter alongside of Judas. Remember, we make the comparison because Judas and Peter, Kepha, they commit the same sin, which is to what?
Betray.
Huh? To betray Yeshua, to deny him, to betray him. And so we have this comparison. What is the distinction between the two? They both commit the same sin, yet one makes it, one does not make it. Why? Because one repents and one does not. So these are types of mashalim. These are types of parable. The word parable means to cast alongside. So you would take this and you would cast alongside that. For example, Yeshua here, he's explaining Malchut Hashamayim. He's explaining the kingdom of heaven. So what does he do? He tells a farm story, a story about a farmer. Because you will not understand Malchut Hashamayim, you will not understand the kingdom of heaven, but you will understand this concept, and that will help you to understand that concept. Thus, he takes this principle and he casts a story next to it so that you have a comprehension. That is mashal. Okay, to lay alongside, to make these comparisons. So here in Matthew 13, Yeshua is telling them mashlim, he's telling them parables, he's telling them stories so that they can understand. They can understand to give them an idea of what Malchut Hashamayim is about. So if you would look, let's go to, for the purpose of what we are studying tonight, that there are goyim, that there are unbelievers, if you would, that there are unbelievers in the kingdom. Everyone is in the kingdom. But not everyone is a citizen of the kingdom. So in Matthew 13, look at verse 24. And he laid before them another mashal, saying, Malchut Hashamayim, the kingdom of heaven, is like a man. This is the verse that we had last week. Is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while the men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed what? Zunin. Right there. Sowed zunin among the wheat and went away. Now when the stalk sprouted and produced grain, then the zunin appeared. The zunin also appeared. So the slaves, evadim, of the landowner came and said to him, Master, Baal, Master, by the way, Baal, everyone say Baal. That is the most common name, Baal, of a false deity, of the chief false deity of the Canaanim, the Canaanites. But Baal, that means master. So, if you would, if in other times, in past times, people would be addressed in more formal terms. So, I remember when I was growing up, some of my mom and dad's supporters and friends and such would send us birthday cards. And so they would send, my birthday would come around and I would have this stack of birthday cards from their friends and supporters, and many of them from Pennsylvania area and things like that. And they were more formal. And so it would say Master Edward King. Now I was only 7 years old. But it would say Master Edward King. Okay? So this is kind of the idea of Baal. That he's the master. So this God, the reason why he's called Baal is because he's the master of all the other gods. He is the highest deity to the Kana'anim, and all the other false gods are under him. Okay? But Baal, if you were to ask in Hebrew for the man of the house, for the head of the home, you would ask for Chaba'al. Okay?
She's not here right now.
She's not here. She's not here. Good. So the slaves of the landowner came and said to him, Baal, master, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Then where did these sunin come from? And he replied, an enemy did this. The slaves say to him, do you want us then to go out and gather them up? He says, no, for while you are gathering up the sunin, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest. At harvest time, I will tell the reapers, first gather up the sunin and tie them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat in my barn. Okay, so what is the idea that's taking place here? So you go down to verse 40 and he has the explanation of it. He sent the crowds away. 36, he sends the crowds away, went into the house. Hatam al-Din came to him saying, explain to us the parable of the tzunin in the field. He said, the one sowing the good seed is Ben Ka'adam, the Son of Man, speaking concerning whom? Yeshua says that the one sowing the good seed is Ben Ha'adam. He's speaking to himself, about concerning himself. The field is Ha'olam, the world. The good seed, these are the sons. Now look, pay attention here. These are the sons of the kingdom. Telling you what? Citizens are non-citizens. If they are sons of the kingdom, they are what? Citizens. Okay? So, the good seed, these are the sons of the kingdom. The tzunim are the sons of the evil one. Now, are they in the field? Since the field is the kingdom, are they in the kingdom? Yes. Even though they are sons of the king? No. The master? No. They are the sons of whom?
The evil one.
Saying what? So there are evil people in the kingdom. But notice the distinction here, that you have the sons of the kingdom telling us these are citizens of the kingdom, but these others, these sunim, are not citizens. But they look like citizens. Just like the sunim looks just like what? The wheat. And it's only to the end that they become distinguishable. They grow up side by side. They look alike. This is why he says, not to try to figure out which is sunim and which is not sunim. Why? Because you may pull out what you think is a sunim, and it's actually what? It's actually wheat. Okay, so he says the enemy who sold them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age. So you have that here, right? Ye get Lekitz, the end. Ha'olam Chazeh, the end of this world. The end of this age. Now you have verse, and the reapers are the malachim, the angels. Therefore, behold, and this is verse 40. Behold, what? As soon as he gathered the pretend wheat and he burns it in the fire, thus shall be the end of this age. Now, what is very important, and this is why we were doing this, what is very important not to just understand tares, but to understand that it is the darnem. That chazumin is what? Pretend wheat. Saying what? There are pretenders. There are pretenders. Saying what? Simply because a person goes to church, claims to be this or claims to be that, does not mean that they are this or that. Just because the person has an appearance of being does not mean that they are. There was a movie that came on a few weeks back that I watched. It's an older movie. Tom Hanks starred in it. And what's the guy that starred in the Titanic?
Leonardo.
Yes.
Catch Me If You Can.
Huh?
Catch Me If You Can.
Yes, Catch Me If You Can.
Very good movie.
And it's a true story about a young man who fakes his way through everything. He pretends he's a surgeon. He pretends he's a lawyer. He pretends he's a doctor. He pretends he's an airline pilot. And he's never been to school. He never got, I think he did a, like, what, he did a year or something of college or something. But he would just, he was a genius, and he would study. He would look at things and he would figure out how to do them. He actually operated on people. And he flew jetliners with passengers. And he figured out how to make checks. And the FBI was trying to catch him. And he would disappear. And he'd reappear. He'd reinvent himself as something else. They finally did catch him. They caught up with him. They arrested him. They threw him in prison. And then they made him a deal. If you will help us to catch other crooks, because one of the things that he was very good at doing was forging checks. He could take a check. He could make a check. He could make the check himself. Not steal a check. He would make it. And it would look exactly like the real check. And then he'd go cash it. And he stole over $1 million by doing this. So they made a deal with him that if he would join forces with the FBI, they gave him his own office, and he worked in the check kiting division, the check forgery division. But he was a pretender. And he could fool everybody. He fooled other pilots, he fooled the airline industry, he fooled doctors, he fooled lawyers, he fooled everybody.
He even fooled the Tom Hanks character when he had it in his hand. That was a good fool.
Correct.
He was right there.
So, saying that there are people around us who are pretenders. They are in the kingdom. They're here with us. And they look like the citizen. They act like the citizen. They talk like the citizen. You cannot tell the difference. Everything is just like the citizen. Except what? They're not citizens. They're pretenders. And as, who was it, Rolando said a moment ago, because you can determine how? By their fruit. By the fruit that is produced. Why? Because Yeshua says that a good tree will not produce bad fruit. And a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. So as the darnel comes up, remember what we said earlier, as the darnel comes up, it looks just like the wheat. It is pretend wheat. It is a mimicker. It looks like the wheat. But it is not until it produces its fruit that you can tell that it is not the wheat. So what? So why does God allow this to happen? Why does God allow this to help us explain, to help explain to us this kingdom in which we live? Why does God allow this? Why does God allow fakers, pretenders, charlatans, masqueraders, whatever you want to call them, why does he allow them to be with his people? Because you and I cannot tell the difference. And the truth of the matter is, it is not our place to make the judgment. Who is it that tears up? Who does he say here? Tears, removes the sunim. Malachim. The angels.
They know.
Why? I do not know. I cannot say for sure this or that. And I'm not, it is not my place to make that judgment. God knows. And his angels know. But I do not know. I do not know who is real and who is pretending. It's like the old saying, right? The only two I trust is you and me, and I don't trust you. And sometimes I'm not sure about me. Saying this, that I mentioned in the Judaism 101 class that I grew up in a denomination that was strict, and a lot of judgments were made. And believe you me, you could not make a mistake in this denomination without being judged. And being the son of a missionary and the son of a pastor made it all the worse. It's called, Charity knows what I'm talking about. It's called living in the glass bowl. Everybody's watching, and if they see the slightest little error, the wrong thing comes out of your mouth or whatever. I thought you were a preacher's kid. I thought you were this, and I thought you were that. We would have people say, things were said like, they went to the movies, or they went to a dance, or they went to this, and the statement would be made, they're probably not even saved. Well, that person, and I heard it all the time, that person is probably not even saved. They're doing this, and they're doing that, and they're probably not even saved.
They're still a people.
We are not called to make such judgments. How do I know that you are saved? What is my guarantee that you are saved? There is none. Why? I cannot see your heart. I can only see what? Your outward appearance, your exterior. Therefore, because I cannot see your heart, I'm not to make that judgment. The other side of that coin is I'm not to use that as an excuse. Because something else that I heard all of the time is this, well, God knows my heart. And my response is, he sure does.
And you should get prayed.
And when I purposely live in disobedience, and I can say, well, God knows my heart. Yes, he does. It's a heart of a rebel. It's the heart of a rebel. So, on the one hand, we're not to be judging one another in these areas because we do not know. The other hand, we're not to use that as an excuse that God knows my heart. It is not okay to worship any willy-nilly way that I want to worship or whatever, not following the protocol that has been set up for us through the scripture. And then say, well, God knows my heart. These things are not for us. And we're to be careful in these things. So look at what he says. In fact, watch what he says very carefully here. Therefore, just as the Zunim are gathered up, just we're going to be done in just a minute. As the Zunim are gathered up and burned with fire, so shall it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man, Ben Chadam, who is Ben Chadam? Yeshua. Will send forth, he is the groom, he's Mashiach, Tiferet. He will send his Malachim, they will gather out of Malchutu, his kingdom, all the stumbling blocks. And those who practice, what's the next phrase?
Lawlessness.
Who are the Sunnim?
Baptists.
Without lawless, Torahless. When Yeshua, remember, Yeshua is a halakhic Jew, speaking to Jews. And he says, these are the ones. These are the Zunim. And they're going to be, they're not citizens. They're not citizens.
I have a quick question. So mm-hmm. This kingdom that you're talking about, it's talking about people in the millennial kingdom, right? Because some of those, a lot of those people, they're going to be citizens there. I'm not citizens, but they're going to live there, but inside, they're going along for it right now. When push comes to shove, they go Torah.
Correct. We talked about this a few weeks back, that the kingdom consists is the kingdom here? Yes. Is it there? Yes. Okay, so the kingdom is now, but it is also then. It is this and it is that. When he says that the kingdom, it says that Yeshua and Yohanan both preached that the kingdom of heaven, Malchut HaShamayim, is at hand, is literally, the Hebrew says, is near, as in when you're standing at the door. That's near. What do you have to do? If someone is at the door, if the king is at the door, what do you have to do? Open the door. And that's what it means that it is near. And what does Yeshua say? I am the door. Okay? So notice he says that the Son of Man, that Ben Chadam, will send forth his Malachim, and they shall gather out of Malchutu, his kingdom, all stumbling blocks and those who practice lawlessness, Torahlessness. So when we are told, when we are taught that Torah is not for today, it does not pertain, all of these things, it's done away with and everything like that, and now compare that to these words. How does that work? And the Malachim will throw them, the Sunin, into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the Tzedakim will shine. Who are the Tzedakim? We talked about those earlier. The righteous ones, these are the citizens, will shine forth as the sun in where? Hamachut le Avi, of their father. He who has ears, let him hear. So what do we find out? Number one, everyone in the kingdom is not a citizen of the kingdom. Number two, we have a very difficult time, oftentimes, distinguishing who is who. Are you a citizen of the kingdom? Or are you not a citizen of the kingdom? You are simply in the kingdom. There is a difference. If you are a citizen of the kingdom, you are a tzaddik, a righteous one. But he tells us how, what is it that makes us righteous when he tells us what makes us unrighteous? What makes us unrighteous? Being a stumbling block to those who are in the kingdom and living outside of Torah. So what makes me righteous? Not being a stumbling block, but being what? An encouragement. And not being without Torah, but living in Torah. And what is living in Torah? To love the Lord, my God, with all my heart, all my soul, all my strength, and to love my neighbor as myself. Now all of this is going to come to play because we're coming to the end of Malchut, and we're going to be, in a few weeks, we're going to be going into Yesod. But, and from Yesod we go into Netzach, and if you remember Netzach, all of this comes into play. Saying, you cannot climb the tree of life, you cannot get into Netzach if you're not a citizen. Because you have these problems here. So, in saying that, Malchut is composed of two types: true citizens and pretenders. They are both there. The pretender, at the end, is recognized by Mashiach and is cast out. And so with that we say, Rachot, Shalom ve'Laila Tov.